are now locked into Radio Juxtapoz, the home of contemporary art and culture conversation.
Coming up today.
Sometimes they're trying to pass themselves off as outsider artists. It's a joke. As soon as someone says, I'm an outsider artist, that's almost like self-disqualification, you know?
This is Radio Juxtapoz.
It's 11:59, December the 31st. 10 seconds are in the thing. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. Everyone's, yeah! What do you do?
I was doing a crossword puzzle. I didn't even know it was happening. What did you do? What were you doing?
I had a civilized dinner with friends.
Oh, so that's kind of nice.
And then we stood in the balcony of their flat and it overlooked London, and we saw all the fireworks going off. All the kids were running about the street because it's actually, you know, kind of a rough area. And all the kids were setting off fireworks at windows and stuff. And it was amazing. It was beautiful. The countdown happened. The fireworks went off. And then the first thing that I saw was an ambulance just going by the street. I was like, oh, I love this city.
You're like, the stats are already starting. I think that the thing that I forgot, and I know you and I tried to get on the pod to do this, but I kind of forgot that it was the end of a decade.
Yeah, we wanted to do that. We were slack on that. Do you know what, though? It's okay, because every other publication in the world rounded up the decade, and we just did our crosswords.
Every generation thinks that the decade they just lived was pretty shit. So I don't... In terms of art, and in terms of social media and podcasts and everything, God, it's all changed so much that it's kind of hard to even start about a reflection, you know?
In terms of growth in all aspects of culture, of technology, of the way we consume things, it's got to be one of the most influential decades. The way and the extent to which we are consuming information, visual information, audio information, whatever that is, so far beyond where it was 10 years ago.
And you know what? What's really kind of cool about that is that it really, really sort of accidentally fits in really well with the person that we're going to talk to later today, because this whole idea of outsider art is like, what is that anymore? Because like, there's really no... The concept of underground and, you know, emerging or things that lay outside of the institutional program, it's changed so much in the last 10 years. So I'm like really interested what Andrew Edlin, who started the Outsider Art Fair, has been a champion of outsider art forever, like how those categories are even established anymore. I think it's really fascinating because I just don't know what's the outside anymore, because everything's blended so many different ways.
Do you want to give a little bit more background on Andrew?
Well, I think like definitely the things that I think our audience should know is, besides the Outsider Art Fair that he's had for years, that's in New York, and as well, it's been in, I think, Paris since 2013. He also has Andrew Edlin Gallery, which is now in the Lower East Side. It used to be kind of on the periphery of Chelsea. My first interaction with Andrew Edlin was a Victor Moscoso poster art show at his gallery in Chelsea. I mean, Andrew would have to say it might be 10 years ago now. And Victor Moscoso was a San Francisco psychedelic poster artist. And I was kind of surprised to see like that particular show in New York, because at the time I was kind of thinking that some of the San Francisco West Coast stuff wasn't really covered in New York as much as perhaps it was. And I just kind of became sort of attached to Andrew's programming because it always seemed so unique and interesting, and psychedelic posters being kind of what the basis of Juxtapoz is, and the concept of outsider art through that was always very fascinating to me. But I've been following his fair now for years, and it's gotten so popular and so influential, which sort of leads me to the conversation that we're gonna have with him today. It's like, what is outsider art anymore, and how do you keep that? I think on the website he talks about Art Brut and that influence on outsider art, and it's changed so much.
It's not the same thing anymore.
Yeah, in the last 10 years it's changed so much. So what are we... How do you keep this authentic historical art form, historical movement? I don't even want to call it. He'll tell us if he calls it a movement, you know, but there's a historical precedent about art that is outside of the institutional academia world and what does it mean now? But it's funny because you and I talk all the time about what's going on in the street art world, what's going on in the Juxtapoz world. And to me, you know, that stuff used to be kind of on the periphery, right? But like now it's like, you know, I'm curious what he has to say about street art and graffiti cultures too, and how it fits into all this.
Graffiti being traditionally within the definition of Art Brut,
right? I mean, it, so
is that, where does that say? I don't want to give too much of this away.
I know.
We're gonna be sat with the guy, and the guy is gonna tell us, and he's gonna know a lot more than we do.
He's an authority on the subject.
He's an authority. I like it when we have an authority on the subject.
People who have dedicated their lives to championing a certain thing, I like to listen to them.
Evan, did you ask him to get a mic?
I asked him to get a microphone. I'm willing to pull out all the stops for Juxtapoz, you know?
And there's our intro.
Well, thank you guys for speaking to me.
No, this is great. First things first, you're about a week out. So what is going on with the prep now for the Outsider Art Fair New York 2020 edition?
Well, we're in the vortex, as I say now, you know? It's just like I got, you know, in my gallery, things are coming, you know, people are shipping stuff over. We do curated booths and special projects, so my gallery sort of becomes the distribution point.
Right.
So I got people coming in and out and bringing things, and then of course I wear two hats. I mean, I got my own booth for my gallery at the fair. So it's funny. That's always like the last thing I like figure out, you know, which is kind of silly because it's a big platform for the gallery. But I'm so worried about taking care of the whole fair and everybody else that, you know, I start to get an idea about now what I'm going to show, you know.
Do those hats ever conflict with each other?
They do, man. It's funny you should ask. It's a challenge because, you know, every one of the exhibitors, obviously some more than others, that take booths from us, you know, technically they're also competitors, you know.
Yeah,
so,
for sure.
So I have to be cool because I don't want to, like, as the fair owner, I don't want to use the fair as a platform to give myself any unfair advantage, you know, over the other dealers. So in fact, I end up like, it's like a disadvantage. You know, I tend not to be able to use any of gallery images to promote the fair. I use other people's images. I try and err on the side of, you know, not looking like I'm favoring myself. I mean, owning the fair in the first place is a big leg up for me as a dealer because, you know, it's you know, put me into a new level of sort of prominence in the art world.
You just like purposefully stick yourself at the back then.
You know, it's funny you say that. This year we actually redesigned like the fair in terms of the layout. I never put myself up in the front anyway, but I'm even further back than I was in the past, you know.
Doug and I, we had a little prep talk before this. It's so funny because we're trying to figure out now in 2020, as social media and the art world has exploded in such kind of undefinable ways now, how an outsider art fair is even defined. Like, how is it still defined as an outsider art fair in 2020?
Well, you know, you can't confuse the context in which art is being shown with the context in which art is being created, you know? So I get what you're saying. On the one hand, because the world is so interconnected now, it's harder for like an artist or anyone to sort of claim like cultural immunity or cultural ignorance.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you know, a lot of art that's still being made that falls into this sort of, you know, genre, you know, artists have different degrees of isolation for different reasons, you know. It seems like increasingly it's more and more about, like, the brain chemistry, you know. People who are coming out of workshops who are along the autism spectrum. You know, I just started working about 5 years ago with Susan King, who, you know, is a severely autistic artist from New Zealand. She hasn't spoken since she was 4 years old. She's just like, nobody draws like her. She's absolutely unbelievable. What keeps her sort of removed from the art world culture that she's not influenced by? Well, in her case, it's just the way her brain is wired, you know? And you got a lot more, there are workshops everywhere. You know, we used to talk about, you know, Googing in Austria and Creative Growth as being the most renowned workshops that help artists with disabilities. And they still are, but they're all over the place now. And, You know, so these artists who are just wired differently, you know, even though technologically we're so far ahead of where we were when Dubuffet coined the term Art Brut in 1946 or seven, still there's, you know, there are reasons why artists are, you know, making work that's not connected to, you know, art historical references. And of course, in addition to that, the areas, the boundaries are just getting grayer anyway, you know.
Right.
It's a phrase that we've already used quite a lot in this conversation, but it's a phrase that we've used a lot in many previous podcasts, but we've never really kind of gone into the history of what outsider art is. Could you maybe talk a little minute about just where this, how we kind of got to this point, where we are today, without kind of going like too far back that we're going to need to really strap ourselves in for 4 hours?
Well, you know, the term Art Brut was coined by Jean Dubuffet in the mid-40s. And Dubuffet, who was a trained artist himself, was finding works being made outside of the salons of Paris, outside of the scene that he was involved in. And a lot of it was in mental asylums or prisons or just, you know, once the word got out that he was looking for things that were just not coming from the usual places, he really made his business to travel all around Europe to find art. And so he coined the term Art Brut, and he believed that because this work was not based on other art or was informed by other art or art history, that it was somehow automatically, I hate to use words like authentic or pure, more original, more exciting to him. You know, and so he began collecting the work, and he started a little underground club called the Compagnie de l'Art Brut in Paris that started to have shows. Some of the surrealists of the day were involved, I believe André Breton and some others who, you know, it was very alluring, and as it is today to trained artists, because, you know, before artists, think about it, you know, your impulse to make art is always when you're a kid, you know, but then you start going to art school and you're under the watchful eyes of your classmates, your professors. If you keep going, then it's the dealer, it's the curator, it's the press, you know, and it's to not let those eyes and opinions, you know, infiltrate how you create is pretty impossible, I would say. That's not to say that contemporary artists and trained artists aren't also highly original, but in this case, the artists that Dubuffet was championing, they almost had to be more original because they weren't working with this vocabulary, which was the common factor in all the other artists who were creating, who were, you know, contemporaries maybe of Picasso, Matisse, you know, what was becoming really popular and commercially viable in Paris and in Europe. So Dubuffet, and then he sent his collection to his friend Alfonso Osorio's house in Long Island. His Osorio was a very wealthy guy out in East Hampton. He had an estate, and he sent virtually his entire collection. I believe it was in the 50s, and it came to Long Island, where it stayed there for 10 years, and that's where people like Pollock and de Kooning, who were friends with Osorio, saw the work. But, you know, I don't want to digress a little too much. And then towards the end of Dubuffet, and remember, this work was still by the, you know, the inside art world sort of looked down upon, you know? And Dubuffet was a revolutionary, really, when it came to that. And he believed so fervently in this work, but he had a lot of trouble convincing people of its value, the local art world. And towards the end of his life, he was looking to donate his entire collection. And I believe Paris really wasn't interested. And he found a willing recipient in the city of Lausanne in Switzerland. And so he donated his collection to the city of Lausanne, which had a building for it, and has now since it's been operating since, I believe, the maybe mid-80s. Dubuffet died in 85, I believe, and it's called the Collection de l'Art Brut. So that's kind of like the mecca of this material. You know, that's sort of like the hallowed ground where you see this Art Brut and outside art in sort of its, you know, most pure form in terms of true to Dubuffet's original definitions and his history. But even there, they had to form an annex that they called Neuve Invention, because there were artists like Chez Sac and other people who Dubuffet decided, well, maybe they were self-taught, but they did have a little connection to the culture. And, you know, so he sort of ID'd even a gray area within his own collection between artists that were really the more completely uninformed Art Brut artists and the Neuve Invention artists who may have had some contact with artistic culture, but still, in his mind, fit into his collection. And then in 1972, feel free to interject at any
time. We're in it now, man. We're in it now.
No, this is good. I'm getting like
the whole... Strap yourselves in, listener.
In 1972, Roger Cardinal, the British scholar who sadly just passed away about 2 months ago, wrote the seminal book, which was called Outsider Art. And I believe he was going to maybe call it Art Brut or something, but his publishers was like, nah, that's French, you know, you got it. And that sort of gave birth to the term outsider art. And then, you know, being the, you know, phenomenal marketers that we are in the United States of America, it sort of became a little bit of a marketing term and an umbrella term, so that outsider art got affiliated with folk art. Folk artists and outsider artists are both self-taught, but folk artists are working in a imagery that's traditional and familiar, whether it's in quilting or with weather vanes or duck decoys or furniture. Maybe it's not, they didn't go to art school, maybe it's passed down on a master to apprentice, or not even, you know? Whereas outsider artists are really working more from completely original imagery from their imagination. But nonetheless, outsider art sort of caught on as a term, and then Sandy Smith started the Outsider Art Fair in 1993. And that became sort of a nexus for people who were interested in this kind of art, but at the same time, now they had a community was really forming around the Outsider Art Fair and the American Folk Art Museum in New York, that was sort of a place that people can come and sort of start to collect this work as a genre in and of itself. And so that was 28 years ago when the fair was founded. And then I would say over the course of those 28 years, but more rapid in a more accelerated fashion over the last 10 years or 15 years, outsider art has moved from being contextualized with folk art to being contextualized with contemporary art. And that's happened for a number of reasons. I think contemporary artists are the biggest fans of outsider art. And to that point, Paul Lasser's curating a booth this year called Relishing the Raw, which is all outsider artworks from the collections of contemporary artists. We've got like Cindy Sherman, Maurizio Catalan, Cause, a lot of really well-known contemporary artists. And I think they love this work because it reminds them of that first impulse to create without all the other baggage and all the infrastructure of the art world and all the demands, you know, from the business side of it. And they can really, that unself-conscious, you know, spark to create is what I think they see in this work. And they've always been sort of the biggest flag wavers for this work. And then the art world has slowly but surely and more as of late really gotten on board with this work. I would say a few watershed moments. I would have to say in 2000, Klaus Biesenbach curated the show Disasters of War, which included Goya, the Chapman brothers, and Henry Darger. And it started at PS1, and about over 4 or 5 years, literally traveled all over the world. So this was watershed because here's the most sort of recognizable or in some case renowned outside artist being shown with the Chapman brothers, who were like YBAs at that point, and like super hip and great young contemporary artists, and Goya, like one of the world masters in art history, and then Darger. So I think, you know, and of course the influence of PS1 and as being such a groundbreaking place for art. And then over the years, more and more museums have started to show the work. I would say another watershed year had to be 2013 when our friend across the street at the New Museum, Massimiliano Gioni, curated the Venice Biennale, and he called his show the Encyclopedic Palace, which was the title of an artwork made by a self-taught Italian immigrant from Pennsylvania named Marino Orridi. And it was that piece was in the collection of the American Folk Art Museum. And so Gioni's show had dozens of outsider artists included. And that was quite, you know, radical, even though in the past, I mean, Wolfley had been shown, I believe, in Documenta in 72. You know, there were little examples, but this was really a very influential contemporary curator. And it wasn't the first time he did it, but the most recognizable time, you know, putting these artists, you know, right in the middle of the whole contemporary art scene. And then that year also, there was a show at the Hayward called The Alternative Guide to the Universe that Ralph Rugoff curated, which was also all outsider artists. Same year, Carnegie International had a lot of outsider artists. It was curated by Daniel Bauman and Tina Kukelski. And so, you know, and ever since then now, the Metropolitan Museum big show of the Souls Grown Deep Foundation out of the South, all self-taught African-American artists, has been going around making these purchase donations to major museums all around the states. And the Met did the most high-profile show two summers ago called The History Refused to Die, named after a Thornton Dial painting. And Judith Scott's solo show at the Brooklyn, you know, this Outliers in American Vanguard Art traveled around. I mean, it's just, I could go on forever, you know.
I mean,
now, now as we speak, some of the high echelon galleries, like David's Werner just did a Bill Trailer show, Venus Over Manhattan, Joseph Yoakam, Barbara Gladstone recently began representing the estate of Guofeng Yi. So it's just now, you know, there's what I sort of, it's the validation machine is really at work, and it's always at work, but it's really picking up steam now.
No, but does it ruin the idea of what outsider art is, that there's all this institutional institutional kind of structure that's now taking it? Does it change like what the actual essence of it is?
It's a great question, man, because it's like, on the one hand, of course, as the community of outsider art people like myself, dealers, curators, we're happy to see the work breaking through. I mean, we love this work so much that for it to reach the widest audience possible and get the recognition we feel it deserves is really heartening and sort of validates our decades of championing the work, you know? But on the other hand, it's tough because, you know, a lot of these major institutions, you know, they have, you know, come to the work at long last, and now that they're here, there's a little bit sometimes of the, well, now that we've anointed it, you know, we have liberated it from this subcategory of outsider art. So they kind of like, at the same time they're championing the work, sometimes they're to my taste too, they're dismissive of what is a really distinct genre of art that has its own museums, its own galleries, scholars that really are experts in this material and steeped in it. And so they come in, and sometimes with their largesse, they feel like they can just say whatever they want about it without necessarily doing their homework, and that, okay, now it's finally arrived. It's like at the Met, you know, they had a Thornton Dial, you know, in a room across from a Pollock, right next to a Clifford Still, you know? That Clifford Still must have been worth $30 million. But, you know, to me, the dial was called Victory in Iraq. I think right now it's on view at the Met Breuer. It's like this assemblage that is just fierce. It's like literally bursting out of the wall. And to me, you know, what it made the Still look like, which was worth 100 times more, you know, obviously I got my own views on things. But the thing that I don't really go for is, whereas the Met may contend, well, this work is great, which it is, and it belongs in this company, which it certainly does and looks great, But that doesn't mean where I draw the line is that doesn't mean there's any relationship between the artists, you know? Pollock, Still, these guys were giants of their era, but they were steeped in the canon. They were very deliberately trying to be innovative and move the canon forward. Dial was like a semi-literate, out-of-work factory guy in Alabama. You know, he grew up as a poor black man in the worst place you could be a poor black man, during the worst time in history you could be a poor black man. And he was brilliant beyond belief. I was lucky to have represented him and spent time with him. The guy was certainly a genius, but he was not in some kind of dialogue, some art historical dialogue. To him, he was making stuff. Now, surely at the end of his life, when he was being shown in museums, he was, you know, it was in the art world. He saw things. He, you know, I'm not saying that some of these influences didn't, you know, penetrate him, but I think it's very overblown sometimes how these relationships are described by the institutional art world. I think they're exaggerated and sometimes even invented, you know? And that sort of burns me a little, because I think you can celebrate something that's great and not be disingenuous about what you call it or what it is.
As an arm of this culture, do you feel quite protective over it?
Absolutely, you know? I mean, I want it. We're all in the, we're in business, you know? We're trying to do business. But, you know...
Is that why you feel protective over it? Because of a business point of view or a cultural point of view?
No, what I'm saying is, I'm saying I'm a business because I'm not trying to sit here and with my halo that is, you know, above my head, you know? I mean, it's like, it's okay to do business, and I love making deals and putting shows and selling art at fairs. But I really feel like, because of my position as the fair owner and as a prominent gallerist in the field, that I have a responsibility to be truthful and honest about what this work is, in my belief, why it's so great, and to not make up stuff, because, you know, it's pretty transparent. Why would people want to draw or exaggerate relationships with more commodifiable contemporary art? Well, so they can justify getting more money for the piece, you know? Listen, that's art dealing, but I'm resisting that, you know? I don't want to make up stuff. Without digressing, before I came into the art world, I was in the food business in the 80s and 90s, working for my dad. And he had a great business, you know? We were selling, like, peanut butter by the truckload and soda and stuff, you know?
Hang on. You can't just say in the food business. Let's go in. you've opened this gate. What arm of the food business are we talking about?
And he was this genius, hilarious guy with no, you know, MBA or anything, who just, like, sold stuff out of the trunk of his car, like jellies, to people who were this little mom and pop store owners who became the founders of, like, big supermarket chains. And over the course of his life, his business grew from 7 cases of this to 7 truckloads of this, you know? And he was just a middleman. But I learned so much from him about business. It's because I'm a broker, right? But it's just like, I stopped doing that because it just, I couldn't get up out of bed.
It wasn't in your heart.
Because it didn't excite me. And I fell into the art world very serendipitously because I had a relative who was an artist, because he was deaf, couldn't market his own work. And when I showed his work around, someone said, "This is outsider art." I was like, "What?" And that's what began things. But the reason I brought it up was, like, I can always go back to the food business if I want to sell groceries, you know? Nothing wrong with that. It's a great business. But I love what I'm doing because this art excites me. And, you know, it's also, I always draw relationships to music, you know, because I'm a musician too. And it's just like, you love the great, why was rock and roll so great? Because it was bucking the trends, you know, at the time, you know. These outsider artists are kind of like renegades compared to the difference is they're unknowing renegades, because they're not voluntarily bucking the rules or the system because they're not hip to it in the first place. But still, the effect is one. And so I feel like, as someone who has responsibility in the outsider art arena, that I want to use those kind of artistic values to inform how the work is sold and positioned. And I just, you know, I think what I worry about is, you know, now that, you know, really big money is stepping in, which is great, you know, on the one hand, but I don't want this work to just become another stock in someone's portfolio, you know?
Do you?
That it means too much to me.
Do you see the institutions?
And I want to continue to focus on what it is, how it's different from other things, and what its unique qualities are, and let those artistic values and qualities of the work inform how I position the work in the market.
Do you see the institutions then taking from what this little pocket is? Do you see them kind of trying to encroach upon it?
There's always been like visionary curators in the museum world, like Massimiliano Gioni, and then there's always been curators and people who just immediately dismiss this work. It doesn't fit into their epistemology. You know? From a commercial standpoint, it's also very significant. Christie's began a dedicated sale of outsider art about 5 years ago. So with their world, their incredible reach, it's just natural that more voices are getting in the picture to spread information about this work and sort of to sanctify that it's okay to collect, you know? Although people in my world have been collecting it for 30, 40 years. But, you know, I don't want to be unrealistic of how much power I have, you know? I own a small art fair and a medium-sized art gallery, you know? The thing about outsider art is it punches way above its weight, you know? It's so powerful, and there's something so authentic and unaffected about it and unselfconscious about it that, you know, people really can relate to it in ways that, you know, there's so much mystery in it. Some of it's discovered posthumously. You know, Susan King is a 67-year-old artist that's one of the best draftspersons I've ever seen, you know? She hasn't spoken since she was 4. She can't really tell me anything about what her work's about, you know? And the art world is so into, like, you know, analyzing and tracing the influences and connecting the dots, which is great too. But there's this inherent mystery in outsider art. I mean, look at Darger's work. It was all discovered after he died.
Right. Yeah.
He's not around to tell us why the little girls have penises, you know? And it's scholars and graduate students are doing their homework and research and coming up with theories. But, you know, to me, I celebrate that, like, that mystery and that we really don't know. But damn, isn't it exciting and interesting to think about?
Andrew, I'm curious, like, what you think about the artwork that kind of was the origins of Juxtapoz, like the psychedelic posters and underground comics and even skateboard graphics and graffiti. Like, how does that fit into this conversation?
You know what? I love that work because, first of all, the drawing, the quality of the dexterity and the draftsmanship is so phenomenal. And also, I love the culture, you know? I mean, I'm a rock and roll guy, you know? And I love the San Francisco music scene, and I love the humor, and I did a Victor Moscoso show also.
Yeah, that was actually the first time I came to your gallery. It was Carlo McCormick, our mutual friend, took me to your Victor Moscoso show, and I was like, at the time I was like, I was still at the point where I didn't realize that people like Victor were getting Chelsea shows. So it was something that to me was like a real eye-opening show.
You know, it wasn't that common, but, you know, again, even though these guys like Victor, you know, went to, certainly is a formally trained artist.
Yeah,
he went to Cooper Union, and as were most of these guys. But to me, they're certainly, you know, outsiders in the fine art world, you know. Even though both Tony Schifrazzi, though, showed Robert Williams, and now Zwerner's had a relationship with Art Grum for a long time.
Yeah.
You know, so these walls are coming down. When something's that great, you know, I believe there's only It's only a matter of time between before everybody acknowledges it and recognizes it. But, you know, there's that whole dichotomy between high culture, lowbrow. I mean, I think it's mostly bullshit. You know, I mean, the work is phenomenal. And then when it comes to, you know, graffiti and street art, you know, I mean, I have a deeper history in graffiti because my brother, Jay Edlin, was quite a well-known figure in the New York graffiti world. He wrote Terror 161 and Jason, and he wrote a book called Graffiti 365 for Harry Abrams, and has gone around giving lectures and stuff. And he's very super well-informed about the culture and still, you know, very much. I think he's giving a talk at the Bronx Museum on February 7th. They're moderating a panel
for Henry's show. Yeah.
Me, I remember like being 13 and my 16-year-old brother coming home at 2 in the morning covered in spray paint, you know? So that's like, you know, my parents freaking out. So I've always appreciated graph, you know, in terms of the context is so much of it, you know? It's a challenge to remove it. Once it comes off the trains and the walls into the gallery, it's hard to really, for that same energy to be captured. But, you know, the draftsmanship, the artistry, you know, in the past, some people have tried to affiliate graffiti and street art with outsider art. And I think that's a little more problematic. I think it's a little bit more genre unto its own. And for me, the way I see it is outsider art is historically really made in secret almost, whereas the audience isn't even part of the equation. It's artists really creating for themselves, you know? And then it's almost always a third party, whether it's Darger's landlord or someone who found Charles Delshow's life work in a dumpster, you know, that recognizes the work and gets it into the public eye. You know, whereas graffiti, I mean, it's get up, you know? Yeah. That's what it's about.
It's about being seen, yeah.
Yeah, so to me, that was always like a line of demarcation where it didn't quite fit into the sort of outsider scene. At the same point, a lot of these graffiti artists don't have training either, and their personal life stories probably do, you know, sort of make them outsiders in some ways. So again, there's a gray area, but for me, you know, on a case by case basis. But if you're like out there really trying to get up and really trying to get your work seen, which that means the audience is a big part of the equation, to me, that's kind of antithetical to what really Art Brut and outsider art is.
Yeah, I like the way that you mentioned we do this with the magazine, but like graffiti is its own thing. It's not under another umbrella. It's right. Kind
and,
of its
and
own.
And the other thing my brother talks about, which I'm not as well informed in, is like, you know, I don't know exactly how did graffiti and hip hop culture become, you know, affiliated with each other. I mean, there's all these cultural cross currents that have happened historically that I'm not really on top of, you know. And the thing that again separates outsider artists, like outsider art is a genre. Sometimes it's falsely referred to as a movement, but
yeah,
you know, outsider artists aren't like hanging out together at the White House, White Horse Tavern, talking about composition and color, right, and their dealers, right, and the press. You know, they don't know. It's got nothing. It's not a community. It's a genre. The community is the community of people who love the work, dealers, museum curators, you know, scholars, people who are studying it, who follow it, even if they don't collect, they just are so enthralled with it. You know, it's a passion.
How is the Paris Fair different than the New York Fair for you?
Well, first of all, you know, I have to give a shout out to Sandy Smith, who founded the Outsider Art Fair in 1993. I was a longtime exhibitor when it dawned on me that I could actually buy the thing from him in 2012. And we got to be great friends during that memorable negotiation. And so I cut a deal to buy the fair from Sandy at the last weekend of the summer. Would have been nice to be out on a boat somewhere, but I was in Manhattan making a deal. And the fair in 2013 was already scheduled in January. So I had to really hustle to get it together. But thankfully, the first fair in 2013 under my ownership was such an amazing runaway success. We tripled the previous year's attendance, you know, that I kind of had something going for me, which was momentum. And I was like, I should do something in Europe. And I thought about London, but then I realized Paris was where the sort of the history and the sort of, it was in the cultural DNA, Art Brut. And then, so now we've had seven editions. We started off sort of old school, like Gramercy Art Fair, you know, by commandeering a boutique hotel during FIAC. And we just took over the hotel and the dealer showed in the rooms, you know? And then we graduated and now we're at our third venue and we have about 40 dealers. So the difference there is certainly, it's just a newer fair, you know? So it's smaller. And also the focus is much more on the European Art Brut. There's not as much of an appetite for like sort of the Southern African-American self-taught material. It's a little more, you know, European Art Brut centric, although we have galleries from Japan and China there. And we had one from Morocco this year. So, you know, in general, the fair is becoming more global. We're getting more exhibitors because it's certainly outsider art or any art transcends any kind of geographical borders. So it's smaller. And, you know, it's also like kind of, it's like we're playing an away game every year, right? It's just like, you know, it's more of a challenge for shipping, for accommodations, just everything. I mean, the good news is it's growing every year and we get better and better at it every year. But, you know, the Outsider Art Fair in New York has always been a standalone event, you know? So we sort of capture all the art world press and attention that next week. We didn't do that in Paris. We didn't think we could really, so we've been doing it during FIAC, which is, you know, the Art Basel of Paris every year. So that's in the Grand Palais and it's a mega, really beautiful fair. So we're one of like five or six satellite fairs of FIAC. So the challenge for us is there, and we've been doing it slowly but surely, is to keep getting people who are going to FIAC, you know, and the other contemporary satellite fairs to come over and visit our fair, you know, and it's working. And we've got some really interesting partnerships over there with cultural partnerships. And but, you know, we started from scratch. So it's really but it's business is really good, though, I got to say. I mean, I go to my art dealing hat. You know, I'm going over there and I'm doing a ton of business out of my booth, as are a lot of the dealers. So, you know, there are a lot of passionate Art Brut and outsider art collectors there, and they come for the fair. They come from all over Europe. They're coming from Belgium, from Germany, from Switzerland, from Italy, you know. So I think it's getting better and better every year, but it's definitely smaller in scale and a little more narrow in terms of its focus within the outsider art genre.
Well, you know, and I don't want to blow too much smoke, but in order to have an outsider art fair, there does have to be this passionate group of people seeking out the work that's different than the traditional art fair sort of setup. So you are dealing with perhaps like a little bit more of, you're really dealing with people that probably do a lot of really good research and are really trying really hard, which I think there is something about that that's very true. And I that's why I feel like maybe perhaps that you guys do get defensive a little bit about, because there is something about it that no matter how much business is involved, there is a little bit extra care in.
Very endearing, because what you find with these guys who are dealing outsider art, they got into it because they love the work so much, you know? And a lot of times they don't have a business background, you know? And so, you know, whether it's the way they hang a booth, or the, you know, the way they're not necessarily keyed into sort of contemporary art world norms, you know? So it's almost like some of the artists, you know, there's this sort of unknowing aspect, but it's very endearing and very charming and done with real love and passion. And it's true, these veteran dealers, and I'm talking about John Ullman from Fleischer Ullman, Frank Maresca from Rico Maresca, Randall Morris and Shari Cavan from Cavan Morris, Arne Anton from American Primitive Gallery, Carl Hammer from Chicago. I don't want to name the whole everybody. I know I'm going to miss someone, but there's great examples right there. These guys know so much about this field of art. They are really the most informed scholars as dealers, but about the history of this work, about the artists, they are really have expertise like no one else. I should say disclaimer, because my wife, Valerie Russo, is the senior curator at the American Folk Art Museum, and she has a PhD and is certainly as brilliant as everyone else. But good, these dealers...
Good plug.
These guys, they've been on the hunt for decades, you know, driving down south, finding the work, and they're such connoisseurs. They have such a great eye, and they can... And you know, I have a vetting committee every year that I use, you know, different groupings of these dealers, because, you know, not only do we vet for quality, but authenticity. You know, there's such an outsiderish style out there now that, you know, these guys forget about it. These guys could look at something and sniff it out, the real thing from the bullshit, you know.
I'm so glad you brought that up, because I was going to ask you, is there like a group of people that kind of like are copying the outsider art aesthetic or something and trying to pass for something? Oh yeah, of course.
Yeah. You know, I wouldn't say they're sometimes they're trying to pass themselves off as outsider artists. It's a joke. If someone says I'm an outsider artist, that's almost like self-disqualification, you know. But it's just like there's certainly a lot of times a dealer will submit something, and then the guys will do a deep dive and find the artist's website and find out see his MFA or something like that, you know? Same time, man, there's a lot of gray areas, you know? Like Charles Steffen is this great outsider artist who became ill in this beginning of his first year of art school. He was schizophrenic, started hearing voices, but you know, he refers to Matisse and Picasso in his work. So, you know, some of these guys are somewhat informed, but, you know, for some reason or another, they certainly are a part. You know, we differentiate between art that is informed by or about other art from art made by these self-taught artists with no academic background.
What has you excited about this year's New York Fair? What, like, are there things that you can tell us that you're kind of getting excited about?
You know, curated booths are always great. You know, I told you about Paul Laster. So, you know, all these really well-known contemporary artists are lending works from their collection, you know. So that's kind of cool. And then Brett Littman, the director of the Noguchi Museum and former longtime director of the Drawing Center, is curating a booth of Peruvian artists. Is really exciting too. Ceramics and paintings, and I think that's going to be fantastic. We have something really cool that speaks to the spirit of sort of the fair and the genre. There's a curator in Paris named Antoine Gentil. He's a good friend and a little bit of a disciple of Bruno Ducharme, who's the owner of the collection ABCD, which is, you know, arguably the most celebrated private collection of Art Brut in Europe or the world. You know, him and the Museum of Everything in London are sort of, in terms of the scale, you know, maybe the top two, certainly in Europe. And Antoine has been curating little shows all over Paris. His family has a used secondhand clothes store that he puts in a corner. He curates a little show all the time. And he's done some tour guiding in our Paris fair. And he came to me with this idea that I went for. There's an artist named Isidore who lives on the street in Paris. And he just shows his work and sells it on the street. And when people ask him how much it is, he says, de votre possible. And that means just pay whatever you want or whatever you can. And so Antoine is curating a booth of Isidore's work. And it's going to be the same de votre possible, meaning when people are interested in the work, what's the price? It's going to be like, whatever you got, you know? And so I think I'm excited about that, because it's kind of a little cutting edge, but also really in the spirit of what makes the outsider art world a little different from the contemporary art world. Otherwise, you know, there's always the top echelon of these dealers that I mentioned earlier. And they've been at it so long, not only are they always bringing new things to the table, but, you know, they're going to show up with a Henry Darger or an Adolph Wolfley or a Martin Ramirez that they sold 20 years ago that they're just getting back, you know, or a James Castle or something that they sold so long ago, you know, and now finally it's coming back into the market. So they're always like, they're like old friends, you know. You see these, you may not ever have seen the work, but it's just like these artists have become so iconic that we're so used to seeing examples of the work. But when you see something that's been sort of under wraps for decades, that hasn't been in any shows or in any galleries, that's also, I think, really exciting. And then you have sort of a new generation of dealers, guys like Scott Ogden from Shrine and Jennifer Loren. Jennifer Gilbert, her gallery's called Jennifer Loren. She's been showing Shinichi Sawada's ceramics, a Japanese artist, that until she got somehow finagled to get them, were like impossible to really find on the market. And Scott always does these great installations, you know, in his booth. So I'm always curious to see. And a lot of these guys, they're just known for having an eye and I guess a nose too, because they find stuff. You know, one thing I always say about the outside art fair, you can guarantee to find something unexpected and be totally surprised by some body of work that came out of nowhere. And you know, I know that's going to be the case too. That's some of the things.
No, I think that's a good place to end, because that was like a really strong, conclusive, like that's a really good statement.
Yay. Thank you. Anyway, man, I really appreciate the time, and it's great to partner with Juxtapoz, who I've been a fan of forever. And thanks, man.